They made it tight. I Let us pray. Our kind and gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, you send us this unclouded day, Lord, here to honor our friend, have a celebration of life for our loved one, Captain Terry Armstrong. Lord, we just pray for each one that's here. We just ask your blessing upon them. Lord, we just ask that you wrap your arms around them and comfort them during this time. For all of this, in Christ's name, amen. First of all, I want to thank the family for giving me the honor of utilizing my friend and brother, Captain Terry Arnold. It is truly one of the highlights, highest honors of my life. My heart goes out to each one of you, and my prayers are and will continue to be with you through this tough time ahead. I wasn't blessed to actually have a biological brother, but to me, Terry Arnold was my brother, Turtle. And I want to share a few of the qualities that I saw in his life that made him that brother to me, as well as a brother to most all of us here. The first thing I think about when I think about Terry is the word big. Not just a big man, but pretty much everything he did was big. He loved everyone big, especially his family and his grandkids. I mean, he showed me pictures from time to time of those new grandkids as they come along. And he really did love big, and he expected nothing in return. And every time we talked, and I'm sure he done the same with you all, every time we talked, he told me he loved me. And if you knew him well, you knew he cooked big. And when he did, we all ate big. You could tell Turtle, look, we're gonna cook for about 30 people. Well, he'd have enough for 300 every time. But he always had a big time wherever he was or whatever he was doing. And you knew that if you ever been anywhere with him. But another thing is he cared big. And he would do anything for anybody, anywhere, at any time, day or night. Today is probably one of the biggest events in Cook County history. And it's big because of him and because he touched us all in some way. The next thing I think about is respected. Today is a testament to this very thing. We have all these lawmen here. We have the governor here. I've never seen an outpouring of love like this in my life. People from all over the state, from all walks of life, are here today because of the respect they had for our fallen hero and friend. Thank you for being here. The next thing when I think about Turtle is old school. And if you know him, you know that's the truth. He learned his craft from serving under some of the best sheriffs in the state, in my opinion, and he was flat good at it. Look people in the eye, shake their hand, let them know you cared about them, and that things will be handled. What more could we ask from our law enforcement than that? The next thing I think about is just Terry. He was just Terry. There was no smoke and mirrors. What you saw is what you got. He was who he was, and to know him was to love him. And of course, he was also Turtle, T-Dog, T-Bone, Big T, and one I give him myself, Tortuga, which was El Tortuga, which was Turtle in Spanish. In fact, I told him, or I had him doing security when Jace Robertson was at our church at Lenox Baptist. And I told Jace, I said, just call him Turtle or Tortuga. He said, I'm not calling that guy Tortuga. He's huge. But I found out later, actually this week, that he named his man cave Tortuga's Tavern. And that meant a lot to me. And so the next thing I think about is heart. He had one of the biggest hearts that I've ever seen. Matthew 6:21 says, for where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. His treasure and his heart were truly here in Cook County. And he absolutely loved all things Cook County, and he supported it with everything he had. The last time I seen him was right over there in that corner, supporting the Hornets. The next thing is he was easygoing. He was an easy person to like, and I don't know a soul that did not like Turtle. Easy to talk to, And like myself, he'd strike up a conversation with an oak tree if it would talk back. "What up, dawg?" was his go-to, and one of these usually followed. "When are we gonna get together and do some cooking?" which me and him did a lot of. "Where are we gonna watch the game? Where are we eating before the game?" And a quick story about a game, he got a little aggravated with the Alabama Crimson Tide back in December, and I said, "Turtle, you need forgiveness for that." He said, "You think the Lord forgive me for that?" I laid my hand on his head and I said, "Lord, forgive Terry for what he just said." The next thing I think about is a reward. Today, he's getting his reward for a life well lived, a watch well served, and a big thank you from all the people he touched in this city, in this county, and in the great state of Georgia and beyond. On Monday, October 3rd, he got his biggest reward when he crossed over to his heavenly home. And I've thought about this since last week. I'm sure he's up there now with a slab of spare ribs on the grill, singing Coal Miner's Daughter with Loretta Lynn because she went up the day after him. So if you pay close attention, what I've just talked about was an acrostic for the word brother. B for big, R for respected, O for old school, T for just Terry, H for heart, E for easy going, and R for reward. And I can only hope that I can be the brother to my family and friends that he was to me. Thank you for being that brother to me. John 15:13 says these words, "Greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends." Terry dedicated his life to serving this county and this school system, and he laid down his life while doing what he loved to do, serving. We circle back to the big point at the beginning, and I want to emphasize again that he loved big. And where did that love come from? John 4:8-16 say these three words, "God is love." Love, folks, is the ultimate expression of holiness, and it is the attribute of God himself. It is an intentional action toward others. When we love others like we should, the invisible God is made visible to them through that love, internal love, like I said. 1 John 4:20-21 say these words, "Whoever claims to love God, yet hates a brother or sister, is a liar. For whoever does not love their brother or sister, whom they have seen, cannot love God, whom they have not seen. And he has given this command, anyone who loves God must also love their brother and sister." And he excelled at loving everybody. And we ask where that love come from. This is where it come from. And I found this out this week. At Community United Methodist Church in Nashville, Georgia in 1997, our friend Terry walked that aisle and asked Jesus into his heart. It was there that God gave him that gift to love big like he did. And that commitment he made assures us where he is today and that we can see him again if we too make that commitment. Again, I thank you all for coming and for this great honor to speak over my brother. Turtle, T-Dog, I love you, man, and it's not goodbye. It's "I'll catch you later, dog."
You know, if the dictionary had pictures, the word unselfishness, there would be a photo of Captain Terry Arnold. Terry dedicated his life to ensure that others persevered, even if he didn't. His life of serving others started at a young age. He grew up hard in the farm fields of Atchison County and came to Cook County over 40 years ago and pursued a career in law enforcement. From there, his journey of service above self began. Never wanting any credit, never wanting any accolades, Terry just wanted to leave this earth better than he found it. Over the past week, the thousands of comments on social media, coupled with news stories from across the country, surmised the impact of this man. Not only did Terry positively alter the lives of the people he came in contact with, but he is also the only man I know that can walk into the governor's office during the transition, get called Turtle, and get a sandwich out of Brian Kemp's refrigerator. We all have our stories about Terry, the life he lived, the impact he had, and the sacrifices he made to make our community a better place. Over the past 15 years, as Chad just stated, every morning at 6 a.m., I woke up to, "What up, dog?" And if I didn't answer the first time, he knew I would on the seventh try, back to back to back. Normally wanting to know if we were drinking coffee at Empire, not to mention the calls to my office when I didn't answer my cell phone, to tell Miss Martha it was urgent, I need to talk to Chase. I'd answer my desk phone to find out that center cut pork chops were on sale at Piggly Wiggly this week, and we needed to grill them tonight. And let's not forget the colorful text message he had sent Matt Bennett and I during truancy court, or his spirited personality watching a sporting event. And all the stories he could tell about the days gone by made you feel like you were actually there. Him and Colin Millison giving their best Charlie Brown impersonation, or how a stern lecture from Judge Blitch or Judge Perkins could do more to straighten out one soul than prison could. Plus the fun times he and had with grilling out, watching Georgia football, or just recently we chose to ride a dirt road and we're singing Cowgirls Don't Cry. And I'm pretty sure that one reminded Terry of his daughters. Terry had seen a lot in his 59 years. He had learned a lot. Not always good, not always bad, but Terry could tell you the lessons of life that would be beneficial to anyone coming of age. In a playoff David Letterman's top 10 list, I thought it would be fitting to have a top 10 list of Terryisms, if you will, that I have picked up along the way. Number 10, when grilling ribs, do not confuse the paprika with the cayenne pepper. It will not end well, folks, I can assure you. Number 9, be careful not to lecture someone about their work ethic unless you've cropped and sand lugs and suckered tobacco in Axon, Georgia. I know Stormy and some of them can speak to that. Number 8, your 30s and your 40s are the best years of your life. Don't let them pass you by, because you'll never get them back. Don't have a wedding or a funeral during the Georgia football game. If you do, be damn certain to have a TV there where somebody can watch it. Number 6, always take a moment and think of Eddard. We get to live free because that individual chose to sacrifice their life for the most exceptional republic ever created by man. And Christopher, thank you. Your service to this country and the sacrifice you made to this republic was one of your dad's most greatest honors. Always respect the thin blue line, number 5 there. That line is the difference between authoritarianism and utter chaos. Number 4, I really don't know if I got this one from Terry or Chad Bush, but when a rebuilt alternator from China is for sale online for 80%, buy it. It's still 80% off. Number 3, Chicago Tribune columnist Mary Smith said it best, don't waste your time on jealousy. Sometimes you're ahead, sometimes you're behind. The race is long, and in the end, only with yourself. Number 2, laughter will cure everything. If you don't believe me, ask Dr. J. He's been scribing it to Terry for years. And number 1, like my brother Chad said, love like Terry. There are many attributes that Terry had, but I do believe his best was the ability to love everyone. When we think about Paul's letter to the Corinthians, it's normally in the context of two people joining together in marriage. But when you dive deep into Paul's message of love, it's one that can be used as a guiding principle. When President Roosevelt took his oath of office in 1933, he had the Holy Bible open to 1 Corinthians 13:13. Because love can be used to guide a nation, and love can be used to guide a life. It guided Terry's life, and in return, he spread love to each and everyone he met and helped during his 59-year journey. As we celebrate the life of Terry Arnold, one must look at the legacy he leaves behind. His children, grandchildren, co-workers, colleagues, Suzanne, and all those that were kind enough to share him with us. Terry's legacy is also filled with contributions to a community that most ever even knew about. For me personally, when the deadly tornadoes attacked Cook County in January of 2017, myself, along with Secret Service Agent Clint Bush, established a perimeter check at US 41 and Valdale Road. The sheriff advised us to create a staging area there at the Church of God for those that cannot reach their relatives. Terry had spent most of the early morning hours driving out survivors in a school bus to a shelter back in town. As the hours passed and still some had not connected with their loved ones and fear began to set in, I called Terry to come to the church. Personally, being overwhelmed with grief and shock, I asked Terry to console the gentleman who was very upset because he could not locate his sibling. Terry, through his love and compassion, comforted this man in a way I'd never seen before. I can honestly say I saw the Lord work through Terry to bring that man peace in that moment. And frankly, I don't know if I could have gotten through that moment or that day without Terry. I will also say that many times Terry commonly would cook food, give it to those in need, even if he wasn't in a financial position to do so. Not to mention all those away football games that Cook County played. Terry would take CJ Lane with him on every one. At Terry's memorial at the county courthouse this week, CJ spoke for all of us when he wrote, quote, "I love you, Terry." Each of us have a duty to carry on Terry's legacy because of the difference he made in our hearts and in our lives. His contribution to this community and this state will live for generations to come. And there's one thing that's evident: Terry had a profound impact on thousands of lives. Terry's life was his campus, and as I've looked around the stadium and this town over the past week, I see that Terry has painted his masterpiece.
Let me do a couple of things first. I'm gonna need this handy. We're gonna try to make it through this. First of all, just to echo what Chad and Chase said, I want you to know, family, what an absolute honor and privilege it is to me to be able to talk about Captain Terry Arnold. So Christopher, Audra, Rachel, Rebecca, Raina, thank y'all personally. It is an absolute honor. Terry was a loving father and a loving grandfather. I have heard so many great things and accomplishments that he shared through the years about each and every one of you. Christopher, to echo Chase's comment, your time in the Army during your service to our country was one of his most proud moments. And he told everyone about during that time about it, and still talks about it today, if you ask him. Raina, your time attending college right now is a big topic of what he talks about nowadays and brings him a lot of pride. But probably your greatest accomplishment to him were the grandchildren that y'all provided. Whether it's Kaya or Chrisley or Caden or Camden's exploits on the athletic fields or whatever Willie has learned new this week along with the rest of the young ones. Too impressive. But Most importantly, he loved all of you very much, each and every one of you. Y'all don't need me to tell you that. You already know. But Terry wasn't just a grandfather and a father. We all know this. He wore many hats, as many hats as he had nicknames. Police officer, deputy sheriff, investigator, school resource officer, personally a boss, partner, co-worker, colleague, world-class barbecue cook, slow pitch softball superstar, karaoke MC and host, an independent songwriter, all-around life of the party, and a hero, for sure. Those are the ones that I have firsthand knowledge on, and a couple of them I want to touch on it for. Because I first met Terry in the early 90s when I came to work at the 8L Police Department. Terry had moved on from 8L at that time and was working at the sheriff's office, where he would remain. As a new, fresh-faced youngin', which is what I was in the business, Terry already was a staple in Cook County law enforcement. And he casted a big shadow. I'm not talking about how wide his shoulders were or his hands that looked like catcher's mitts. I'm talking about his ability to talk to anyone. To handle any situation, no matter how dangerous, without having to resort to aggressive or heavy-handed tactics. Terry could sell ice to Eskimos, as the saying goes. I wanted so desperately to learn how to do that. In the early 2000s, I made my way over to the sheriff's office with Terry and the boys and had the ability firsthand to see and learn how Terry from Terry, how truly it was to be a deputy sheriff. I have told people for a long time that Terry was not just a deputy sheriff, he was the deputy sheriff. These guys behind me and to my left here are all familiar with a program that our honorable governor spearheaded a couple years ago, where he brought de-escalation training to law enforcement on a yearly basis. I always joke with these guys that de-escalation training was pretty easy if you're a small town rural deputy sheriff and your closest backup is 10 miles away. You didn't have much trouble in de-escalating most situations. But I think the governor may have missed his opportunity. He could have sent Terry around the entire state and he could have taught everybody what de-escalation was all about. I had the opportunity not long after joining the sheriff's office to work investigations with Terry, where he was my direct boss. But since there was only two of us, he was also my partner. We spent many long nights on crime scenes and early mornings furthering investigations from the night before. My wife always tells people about a homicide investigation we assisted the Georgia Bureau of Investigation on that kept us from the house continuously for 4 days. And those wonderful people that worked with the GBI during that time that we have become lifelong friends with over the years. We had a rough run of late night calls outs for a period of time that they assisted us with. So many late night calls that me and Terry wrote a song called Waiting on the GBI. It was complete with verses and choruses and had a hook the whole nine yards. And Terry and I often laughed about that, even now, but neither one of us could remember the words after all these years. But as I recall, it's pretty good. Now, Terry worked in every division of the sheriff's office at one point in time or another, but eventually he was led to his current position as the captain over our school resource officer program. If there's ever been a better SRO, I've never met him. You could say Terry found his calling. But his calling had always been to be a law enforcement officer, and he was a proud one for sure. But he definitely found the place where he could make the most impact. He loved everyone and everything about our school system. He was so proud to be a big part of the Hornet Nation. You could always find him on Friday nights right down there in that corner. He did that for all sports, not just football. If there was something leaving here or going somewhere, and it had to do with the Hornets, Terry was probably leaving. My wife tells about the investigation that led us away for 4 days. But what she doesn't know is that it actually kept Terry away for 5 days. But he let me come home early because my daughter had a beauty pageant that Saturday. And he was very proud of my children. He loved my children like he loved his own children and was very proud of their accomplishments, even if he wasn't more proud of them than I was. I'd like to say that we were special in that regard, but I know we weren't, because I know he'd done it for everyone else's children. Because see, Terry, he loved you, and he loves your children, and he wished the best for him, just like he did mine. So just for example, if you people out here or your children have ever been positively impacted by Terry Arnold's work as a school resource officer or a deputy sheriff in Cook County, I kindly ask you real quick to please stand. Guys, that's all that needs to say. And to steal a line from one of Terry's favorite movies, Forrest Gump, that's all I got to say about it. Because that absolutely says it all. Now, much has been made, as it should be, because everyone knows the grilling and cooking exploits of Terry. So I won't rehash all that. But I will say he has cooked the Thanksgiving turkey for my family and all the families of the sheriff's office for better than a decade, every night. And I sure wish I'd have paid better attention, because November's gonna be tough. But not only could Terry cook, Jerry Wayne, he could eat. Terry had an iron stomach, to put it lightly. Potted meat, sardine, hoop cheese, and one memorable pickled pig's foot. The man could and would literally eat just about anything, and the spicier the better. On one of those long investigations that took us away from Cook County, we hadn't eaten in quite some time, so we stopped at a little mom and pop grocery store for a snack. We get up to the counter, we're getting ready to pay, and Terry spots this Pickles Pigfoot jar, and it had one little pig's foot, like, floating in the top of it. Now, I don't know much about Pickles pig feet, but I know the water ain't supposed to be white. And this water was white, and it's just bobbing there. And Terry, he looked at the little lady behind the counter, and he said, "I'll take that one right there." And she wrapped it up, and we got in the truck, and he gnawed on that pig's foot all the way to our destination. And I told him, like I told him many times, I said, "T, I just don't think I can eat that." And his comeback was always the same: "Well, you ain't never been hungry then, have you?" So I said, "Well, T, I don't guess I've ever been that hungry." He'd say, "Then you ain't never been poor." I said, "Fair enough." But finally, I want to leave you with one last thing. And they say a hero is an ordinary person who faces extraordinary circumstances and acts with courage, honor, and self-sacrifice. Terry was a hero. And it's my absolute pleasure to be able to assist with something. It says, by the sheriff of Cook County, Georgia, whereas I, Douglas G. Hanks, the duly elected sheriff of Cook County, Georgia, being both sound of mind and decision, vigilantly monitors and evaluates the respective performances of members of the Cook County Sheriff's Office. On Monday, October 3rd, 2022, Captain Terry R. Arnold suffered a sudden cardiac death after dispersing a fight between two students that occurred at Cook County High School. Whereas Captain Terry Arnold has recently completed his 26th year of service to the Cook County Sheriff's Office and the citizens of Cook County, and his 35th year as a law enforcement officer in the state of Georgia. Captain Terry Arnold passed away in the line of duty during his current assignment as the supervisor and director of the School Resource Officers Program for the Cook County Sheriff's Office and the Cook County School System. Captain Arnold demonstrated loyal, meritorious service and steadfast leadership during not only this assignment, but throughout his years of service to the Cook County community and the state of Georgia. Therefore, I, Douglas G. Hanks, Sheriff of Cook County, do hereby posthumously promote Captain Terry Arnold to the rank of Major. Claybo, will you come up, please? That's the first time I've made it through reading that, so I don't know what that means, but Terry was a hero not for the way he died, but for the way he lived. And in closing all of the hats that Terry wore and the names he had, the most important one for me was he was my friend. And if you ever met him, and he was your friend too, and Terry would want me to tell you to make sure every day you tell the people you love that you love them. Suzanne, Jerry Wayne, Stormy, family, kids. Terry loved you. And you know he loved you. And you know how you know he loved you? Because he told you every day, just like he did me and all these people up here. I know my friend loved me because he told me he loved me. And I loved him. Thank you.
Good evening, everybody. I'm Trent Exum. As Terry affectionately known me from the first time he met me, he called me Trentster. I'm sure y'all all know nicknames. I don't know that Terry ever called anybody by their real name. I could look around here and name 1,000 right now. He doesn't even call his son by his real name. So I'm sure if you know him, you know you have a nickname. I'm sure everybody's been called something. Also, in the last couple days, I've come across several people who advised me that they have phone call times every day. Mine was at 8 o'clock every morning. I got called at 8 o'clock. It would start with, "Trentster, what you doing?" And he knew what I was doing because he was passing me right down here at the split doing school traffic, but he had to ask me. And if I didn't tell him I was doing the split, he'd correctly tell me how I was lying to him, and he didn't like to be lied to. So my time was 8 o'clock. I talked to Judge Daughtry. I think he gets a 6:45 wake-up call every morning. Chad Bush just told me he got it a little after lunch. So I'm sure everybody here had a certain time, but mine was 8 o'clock. And come tomorrow morning at 8 o'clock, if my phone don't ring, I'm going to be a mess. And I'm sure the rest of y'all are. So if anybody feels free of calling me at 8 o'clock, I'm probably not going to answer. But having said that, I want to say my favorite Bible verse is out of the book of Philippians in the Bible, and it fits Terry very well. It says, "Don't worry about anything, but pray about everything." And I think that is perfectly fitting for Terry, because I've known him 22 years and I've never seen him worry about anything. He's never had his blood pressure up. He's never got red in the face. He's never got mad. He just looks at you and says, "We got this." We got this. I've heard that 5 million times. We got this. So from now on, guys, when y'all come across something, I'm going to tell you, we got this. We got this. Terry wasn't a very spiritual man. He believed in Jesus. He was a Christian. We talked about it. Me and him have weekly Friday night football talks right over in that corner. That was our corner. Every football game, you see us two sitting right there. It was a long game because Terry was giving me play-by-play like he was a radio announcer on TV while we were sitting here watching the game. But it was a good game. I learned that he told the coach about how Berrien County is going to play the offense, or he talked to the defensive coach about Sumter County's running back, and I'm absolutely 100% sure he told him, but he would tell me standing right over there that they're going to win this week because he had a feeling. He had a feeling. And the only time he didn't have a feeling, and Antonio over here will tell you, was this week coming up. And this is a fitting week because Cook plays Berrien Friday night. And as much as Cook County loves him, and as much as he loves Cook County, he loves Berrien County too. And every year, same corner, me, Terry, and Antonio would sit there. And Antonio would bet Terry that Cook County is going to beat Berrien. And Terry would drag it along 3 or 4 games, but eventually he'd take the game. And he would he'd take the bet. And last year, Berrien beat Cook. And I don't know that Terry ever paid him, but I've heard about it all year long. So Antonio, I know he never got back to you, but I'll take his bet this year. I'll bet on the Hornets, which hurts me because I'm from Berrien County, but Terry deserves that. I'm not the speaker that these guys are, and it really hurts to go behind them when you're not a speaker, but I'm going to fight through it. The reason I'm going to fight through it is I know Terry's sitting there laughing at me because he knows this isn't what I want to do. He knows I don't talk to people, and he's laughing at me right now, but I guarantee you, Terry, I'm going to do it for you, buddy. I'm going to fight through this. Excuse me. Not only did me and Terry meet here every Friday night, but right over here in front of the auditorium, every day after school, me and him would meet before school got out, and we'd have long conversations. Every day, it would start with a picture of his family, one of his grandbabies, a new one, everything from Christopher in the military to a sonogram from a grandbaby that's not here that he treated like it was a real picture, and he would point out the little areas. And I don't want to go too far in, but he would show me why he knew it was Arnold. And he'd point to a certain area and say, "That's an Arnold right there." If I tell him I didn't see it, he'd get out of his truck and come over here and put it right in my face and point it out. I said, "That's an Arnold. If you don't see it, something's wrong with you. That's an Arnold." I want y'all to know, y'all all had Arnolds. I seen sonograms. I know they're Arnolds. So, but we would have long talks, and part of our talks starts from when he hired me 22 years ago, and I can guarantee you through the last day I seen him, just like Mr. Chad sitting right over here, he reminded me he hired me 22 years ago. And I've yet to pay back that favor, apparently. But he did hire me 22 years ago when I walked in. I walked in with him and Colin Millison. He looked at me. He pulled my application that clearly had my name as Trent Exum on it. And he told me that day, "I'm going to call you Trentster." Until Monday, I've been Trentster. And I have no problem with that. But we would have a talks, and he would remind me, and I'm going to miss it. Y'all are going to miss it. But we're a big group. All the families over here, but I want y'all to know that this group over here, we're your family too. We're going to get through this together. If you need us to help you, we're all a phone call away. Because as much as he loved y'all, I guarantee you, he loved these guys. And these guys love y'all the same. Terry Arnold taught me a lot about policing, but he taught me how to teach people. He taught me how to treat people. Terry taught me how to greet people with a smile, a handshake, and a hug. And that's it. Everybody, he told me if you could do those three things, nothing else mattered. They can't be mad at you if you hug them. I looked at him and said, Terry, what if they are mad at me, want to fight? He said, you ever see anybody mad at you when you hug them? And I don't guess I have, but if you ever wonder if you're around a bad situation, take Terry's advice. Smile, handshake, and a hug. It goes a long way. So I'm going to, these guys have told y'all personal stories about Terry, whatever. I'm going to tell y'all a couple work stories because there's many, several I can't mention out here, but I'm going to tell you two of my favorites. When he hired me 22 years ago, he told me that there was a policy that the young guy took the captain out to eat on Monday to wherever he wanted to go, and on Friday, the captain would take that rookie and feed him. So I'm 19 years old, fresh out of college. That sounded pretty good to me. I had a little money. So Monday morning, I went to Terry. I looked at him. I said, where do you want to eat, Terry? And he said, Trinster, let's go. And we went to Hardee's, to every restaurant in this town. We would go Monday. And on Friday, he would take me to the steakhouse. Every Friday, on his day, we would go to the steakhouse. This rocked on for several months, which I never minded, because time with Terry was very special. You're always laughing, so you didn't mind. But we rocked on. I bought every Monday, and every Friday, we'd go to the steakhouse. And I'm real careful saying he bought. I would come in, we would go to the front desk, he'd ask me what I'd want, I'd always get a buffet, he'd say, go get us a table, Trister. I'd go get a table, I would look behind me, Terry's at the front desk, I'm assuming he's paying the lady, and he'll come join me, we'll have our dinner, and it'll rock on. Well, after 3 months, all I can imagine is sympathy, Colin Millicent come up to me and he said, I can't do it no more. I got to tell you what's going on. I said, what is it, Terry? What is it, Colin? He said, well, for the last 4 or 5 years, we eat free on Friday at the steakhouse. And it took me back for a minute. I'm 19 years old. And I said, what'd you say? And he said, yes, we eat free at the steakhouse on Friday. So, 19-year-old fired up. I thought I'd go get to the bottom of this with this 300-pound bear of a man. So I walked back to his office. I slung his door open. He stood up, smiled at me, shook my hand, gave me a hug, and told me we didn't have to go eat on Monday. So I counted that as a victory. I felt like I scolded him. I turned around, walked out of his office, and went to work. And that is another thing that every Friday night, right there in that corner, he reminds me of. Because that was very funny to him. And I do my best to carry that on to the new guys now. But I'm pretty sure Terry reminds me that that was the best he ever got a rookie. And I'm grateful that it was me. My second story I want to tell was a work story, but it's a little personal too. When Christopher come back from the military, Terry got us all together at work and he wanted to throw a big, huge party for Christopher because I can tell you, Christopher's military made him just as happy as I've ever seen him. So we went to Terry's house on a Saturday night. We had the party. Terry, as always, was standing at the grill. We were all around enjoying it. It's the first time I actually met Christopher. We were all talking. Terry was by his famous grill that they now call Bertha. He was grilling chicken, as he usually does. Terry had on a white t-shirt and a pair of vinyl basketball shorts. And if anybody's ever been to a party Terry has, you know Terry loves to throw parties and have people over. Well, this grill, as Chad McDaniel can tell y'all later, has a special way to open it. If you don't open it right, it will explode and blow you up. It's cost Corporal McDaniel a helicopter ride one day at work. But Terry opened this grill that night, and it threw out the fire. And of course, Terry knows that it's going to make a flame. He stepped back, and he kept cooking and going. And then Colin looked down and said, "Terry, your shorts are burnt off." And it was just them two. They're the only two that knew. Terry looked down, and sure enough, his vinyl shorts were melted completely to his legs. They were nothing on the front but red melted vinyl. And yes, it was that visual. I remember it was red. Well, Terry finished cooking, looking Colin to wash the grill, and Miss Darla took Terry to the Berrien County Hospital. No one knew Terry was gone. Terry left. They pulled off very much similar to what I think the governor will do in a minute. They left. We kept partying. We was having us a good time. An hour and a half later, Miss Darla pulled back up, and Terry got out with his legs completely wrapped from his waist all the way to his knees. We, of course, didn't know what was going on. The only person who knew was Colin. Terry went inside, put on another pair of basketball shorts that come out just short enough you could see the white on underneath it. He walked directly to the grill and was there just long enough to tell Colin he was grilling wrong. He was burning the chicken, and that's what Terry was worried about. With fourth and third degree burns on most of his legs, he was worried about the chicken and everybody else. And that's the type of person Terry was. If Terry knew you, he loved you. If you're out here and you know Terry, he loved you. You talk to him on the phone, before he would hang up halfway through the conversation, he would say, "I love you," and then hang up. And you would still be talking for 2 minutes before you realize he was gone, because he's already had two more calls since then. But he loved you. That's what I want you to know. He loved his family. He loved his grandkids. He loved his school. He loved each and every one of these guys over here. He loved the guys behind us. And most importantly, if you take your finger and stick it at your chest, he loved that person. Because I can tell you, if you're here, Terry loved you. And if you don't believe it, he probably told you. Because I get told 4 or 5 times a day on a slow day. So, ending all this, to our conversations over here, Terry's job at the football game was to handle the SROs and what happens on the inside. I had to take care of the parking lot and what happened on the outside with our guys, who work very hard. And we don't tell you, but we appreciate you. We have the new parking lot. Dr. Dixon, you're going to have to forgive me. I may upset you. I'm sorry. We have this new grass parking lot that's for the football that absolutely drove Terry crazy. Every day, every game, every graduation, somebody complained about the dirt parking lot. And I would tell them, when they come to us, go tell Terry. And Terry would take it, and he had all intentions. And after every game, he would look at me and say, "I'm going to get Dixon money." And I have no doubt he went and seen Mr. Dixon on Monday. We had that conversation after every game. To the point, if you're from Clinch County here, I want to apologize beforehand. But we had a bad rain at the Clinch County game. A lot of people from Clinch County complained, and I sent them to Terry, and Terry come to me, and he goes, they don't even wear shoes in Clinch County. Why are they complaining about my dirt field? So, that was usually our conversation. So I told Terry 2 weeks ago, Leo was standing there with me, and I kind of regret I said this, but now I'm glad I did. But I told him, Terry, one day you're not going to be here. God knows I hoped it was a long time from now. But when you're not gone, I'm going to go to Dixon, and I'm going to get that parking lot dedicated to you. And he told me if I did, he would haunt me the rest of my life. So, Mr. Dixon, I don't mind getting haunted if you want to do that. That's just something I'm going to tell you. But he loved it. He loved this football field. He loved this football team. He loved that parking lot as much as we picked on him. But most of all, our talks revolved around our kids, our grandkids. When I met Terry 22 years ago, I didn't know him. Now me and his son, Christopher, are as close as we can be. My son and Christopher's son plays baseball together and have for many years. My oldest son, Clayton, went to daycare with Rayanne. She actually stole one of his pacifiers when he was little, but we'll let that ride too. But he loved y'all. We talked about it. And every day, he'd ask me how Cooper and Caden's ball team was, how they did on the away game, and I'd tell him. And I remember one day in particular, I said, Terry, we're fixing to, they're going to the region championship in middle school. These boys are tearing it up. And he looked at me, and he said, do they have the big head yet? I said, no, I don't think they have the big head. They're playing good. He said, well, when they do, let me know, and I'll get Chrisley to come out here and show them how to play baseball. So, Caden, if you need help, she's right beside you. But having said all that, I'm going to close out with this one thought. Saturday night, I was sitting alone at the house trying to figure out what I was going to say. And I was watching college football, which I'm sure Terry was doing too. And after the game, one of the announcers started talking about a Mount Rushmore for college football. And there was four or five that argued over who it was, and I'm sure everybody's got their opinion. I know Terry did. I got to thinking about Terry, and I thought, would Terry be on the Mount Rushmore for policing? And I'm looking here, and I would think he would definitely be a possibility. But then I got to thinking, I don't want to pigeonhole him as a police officer, because that wasn't what he took pride in. Then I realized Terry Arnold would be on a Mount Rushmore as a human being and as a person. And the fact that all of y'all are here proves that. Terry was a great man. I'm going to miss him. We're all going to miss him. But we'll get through this together. We're all here. And I promise you, he's in heaven right now, laughing at the fuss we're making over him, because he didn't like it. He's laughing about it, but secretly he's poking Jesus in the side, because I guarantee he's sitting next to him grilling chicken, and he's asking if he had that many people at his funeral. Because he deserves every one of y'all. Everybody here, he deserves it. And I'm going to close this with saying, guys, we love you. He loved you. And Cook County's got a great loss, but know that Terry loved each and every one of y'all. He loved you, Suzanne. He loved you, Christopher. Loved you, Audra. Loved you, Rayanne, Rebecca, Rachel, grandkids. He loved you. And most importantly, these fellas behind me, he loved the Cook County Hornets. So if y'all want to dedicate Terry, come out here on Friday night and support these guys the way he would want you. Okay. Thank y'all. If you will look at the screen, the high school AV unit has made a video.
Sing it. rushing out.
Terry, what's your prediction on the score? Real quick, hurry up for this play happen. Score.
Gonna be a long another graveyard shift.
We'll check back at halftime.
And he says goodbye to his wife and kids. It's been his life just like his dad's. Driving away under the weight of the badge. Seen it all in his 15 years. Watching our backs, facing our fears. Lord knows it ain't no easy task. Keeping us safe under the weight of the badge. He swore that oath to protect and serve. Pours his heart and soul into both those words. Lays his life on the line. The mighty walks his razor fine. Tempered strength is always tough. But he ain't gonna buckle under the weight of the band.
Thank you.
stand with me, please? Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you for this day. We thank you for this life well lived, this watch well served, Lord, and this friend to us all. We thank you for every scripture that was read, every story that was told. Lord, and for all the people, Lord, that loved him, because he truly did love. We know that's the common theme of the day. He loved us all, and we all loved him. And Lord, we thank you for everybody that had a part in planning one of this biggest events in Cook County history, but he deserved it. And Lord, just ask a special blessing now upon his family, Lord. As we said earlier, Lord, we know that there's going to be a big hole in their hearts, Lord. Only you can feel, and we pray that you feel that. We pray all this in Christ's name. Amen. And then the interment will be at Greg's Cemetery, and you're welcome to join us there if you'd like.
Yeah, he got it.